Florence Harding.
Now from New York, Roy Porter, social historian and author of The Greatest Benefit to Mankind, A Medical History of Humanity. He discusses the connection between medicine and wider social trends. The event lasts about an hour.
Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to the New York Academy of Medicine. I'm Ed Moorman, the Associate Librarian for Historical Collections and Programs. It was quite a thrill for me to get a call from the Norton Publishing Company a couple of months ago asking if we might be willing to sponsor the event tonight. I'm just thrilled to have Roy Porter here with us. Roy Porter is certainly the most prolific medical historian of our generation, possibly of any. And besides writing a lot, he also writes well, which is an added incentive to read his book. He writes well, and he writes about interesting stuff, and the things he says are worth saying. Roy graduated from Cambridge University. He was born in London. He's very proud of that. I was born in New York, and I know how he feels. He graduated from Cambridge University with a BA in 1968 in history. His PhD in 1974 was in history of geology. And I first became familiar with his work on the history of geology. It was published in book form in the late 70s, I guess. He was a lecturer at Cambridge until 1979, when he returned to London to the Wellcome Institute for the History of Medicine, where he was promoted to professor in 1994. And if you know the English academic system, being a professor there counts for something more than it does here. Roy has written or edited over 70 volumes, and he almost punched me in the face when I said it's more than 40 by now, isn't it? He said, you're way behind, Ed. Four of his books that he asked me to specifically mention are Mind Forged Manacles and A Social History of Madness. And if he did nothing else, he'd be a major historian of mental illness and psychiatry. Two books that he's particularly proud of are Patient's Progress and In Sickness and in Health, which document the history of medicine from the patient's point of view. And it seems to me that every 20 or 30 years, someone comes along and says the history of medicine must be the history of patients. Says it in a programmatic way. Roy has gone out of his way to do the empirical work and produce books that deal with that. I should add that there are a couple of books that he's edited that I have contributions in. And it's very hard to write anything in history of medicine and not be edited by Roy Porter at some time, but I won't mention those since those weren't on the list that he gave me. It's quite a thrill to have Roy here, as I said, and I'll turn it over to him now. After he talks, we can have a period of questions, and we'll place Roy at that table afterwards, and anyone who's bought a book or wishes to buy one can bring it over to him to get it signed. So welcome very much, Roy.
It's a great pleasure and privilege to be at this academy this evening. I'm a historian, and many of you are medics. I am the past, and many of you are the present and the future. And what I want to do in my talk this evening is to offer some thoughts about the relationship between the history of medicine and how we should be thinking about the problems and the opportunities for medicine today in a wider historical perspective. Many people believe, and I'm one of them, that we stand at one of those moments in medicine when doctors are surveying their own history for the obvious reason that many doctors are deeply perturbed about the present and fearful for the future. And the reason for that is clear. In this country and throughout the Western world, medicine may well be at a crisis, a crossroads. You don't need me to spell out the nature of the problems. I think, in fact, it's been very well suggested in a recent book by William Kizik called Medicine's Dilemmas, Infinite Needs versus Finite Resources, sums it up in a title. After pointing to the alarming fact and paradox that, as Kizik puts it, healthcare in America consumes 14% of the gross national product, yet some 40 million citizens are uninsured, he goes on to state what he sees as the modern dilemma. I quote, "The golden rule of healthcare in our society is that everybody deserves the finest healthcare attainable, provided that someone else pays. But in what I call the iron triangle of healthcare, access, quality, and cost containment have equal angles representing identical priorities, and an expansion of any one angle compromises one or both of the other two. All societies confront equal tensions amongst access to health services, quality of healthcare, and cost containment. Trade-offs are inevitable, regardless of the size of the triangle. Call them resource allocation or rationing, they are choices our society must make." Kizik's dilemma has been restated this year in starker form in another admirable book, a book called False Hopes: Why America's Quest for Perfect Health is a Recipe for Failure, by the medical ethicist and publicist Daniel Callahan. Callahan pours cold water on current expectations of ever-improving health, lethal diseases, the final defeat of which was proclaimed some 30 years ago by the Surgeon General, but vainly, have now come back with a vengeance. Not just AIDS and other superbugs, but a resurgence of tuberculosis, pneumonia, and so forth. What's more, it's most unlikely that the near future will bring any major victories in the struggles against heart disorders, cancer, stroke, Alzheimer's, and other of the chronic killers. Much vaunted high-tech procedures, of course, save individual lives and must not be belittled, but mostly they don't actually cure diseases, being rather of the patch-up kind. And such band-aid medicine doesn't really add much to the healthiness of populations at large and is always inordinately expensive. Back in 1970, the United States was channeling something like 7.4% of its GNP into healthcare. Now the percentage is almost 15%. In other words, it's just simply doubled in the last 30 years. Given there is no clear-cut correlation between health and healthcare expenditure, before that factor doubles again, throttling all sorts of other desirable social investment, isn't it time to say enough is enough, or at least to say when and what is enough? And here is where history comes in. To be in a position in which one is faced with a choice is always a privilege. Dealing with necessity is easier but more dire. When faced with choices, people turn to history. One book surveying the present crisis, a book called Vandals at the Gate of Medicine, a book by a Professor M.A. Faria, Professor of Neurosurgery in Macon, Georgia, offers itself in its subtitle as precisely that. The subtitle of that book is called Historical Perspectives on the Battle Over Healthcare Reform. Now, I, for one, having read Professor Faria's book, happen to think that what he calls historical perspectives are largely ahistorical perspectives, or unhistorical perspectives, or even anti-historical perspectives. I don't think, in other words, his history is very good. And this is an important matter, Because if we're genuinely looking for historical guidance, rather than merely trying to buttress our prejudices with choice bricks from yesteryear, we ought to get our view of the past right. Now, I don't want this evening to engage in a kind of political war upon historical battlefields, though being an Englishman, I might do battle with Professor Faria's contention that socialized medicine has always been part of the road to dictatorship. I mean, we've now had 50 years of the National Health Service and don't yet seem to have Hitler in charge. But it is my aim to suggest that and to show how today's problems are largely the consequence of yesteryear's progress and expectations. Today we're paying the price of progress. We are victims of two totally desirable and, may I add, extremely American developments in medicine over the last couple of centuries, namely scientific progress and the desire for democratic openness. First, let me remind you briefly how recent and how rapid medical progress has actually been. In 1940, penicillin was only just being tried out on mice. Not till 1943 did it go into mass production, and for some years it remained in short supply. Before, such magic bullets, pneumonia, meningitis, and comparable infections were still frequently fatal. Tuberculosis, the white plague, that was long the most important cause of all adult deaths in the developed world, was given the coup de grace in the 1940s by the 1-2 of the BCG vaccinations and streptomycin. Thanks first to the sulfur drugs and then to antibiotics, maternal deaths in childbirth, still appallingly high in the early 1930s, dipped towards vanishing point. For the first time ever, childbirth became safe for mother and baby. The 50s extended the first pharmacological revolution onto a broader front. This beat the bacteria, improved control of deficiency diseases and many biochemical abnormalities, produced the first effective medications for mental illnesses, and came up with a Salk vaccine against polio. Other drug breakthroughs, notably steroids, made it feasible to capitalize on growing understanding of the immune system. By tackling the rejection problem, immunosuppressants opened untold possibilities for grafts and later transplant surgery. The plastic surgery techniques pioneered during the Second World War constituted one of the many salients through which surgery became the most prominent branch of healing. Cardiology blossomed. One milestone was the first surgical intervention 54 years ago for blue babies born with congenital heart disease. Thereafter, pediatric cardiology forged ahead. Bypass operations, another leap forward, date from 1967. And by that time, surgery was becoming a little bit like space travel. It seemed to know no bounds. Organ replacement was developed, first with kidneys, and transplants became banner headlines in 1967 again, when Christian Barnard sewed a woman's heart into Louis Washkansky by an ominous stroke of what the critic Ivan Illich has called medical nemesis. The South African surgeon's career was to be cut short by, of all things, arthritis. By the mid-1980s, hundreds of heart transplants were being conducted each year in this country alone, with two-thirds of the recipients surviving for 5 years or more. In our lifetimes, surgery has not just grown, its very nature has been transformed. Earlier this century, its essence lay in extirpation. Locate the lesion, track the tumor, and then cut it out. Now its philosophy has become one of continuous repair and perhaps almost endless replaceability. And meanwhile, alongside these practical leaps forward in intervention, science has been helping healing to a degree scarcely predicted, even in those halcyon days of the 1930s, when Wellesian prophets still felt sanguine about science's benevolence. Electron microscopes, endoscopes, CAT scans, PET scans, MRI, ultrasound, these and many other technological devices have revolutionized medicine's diagnostic capacities. Lasers brought microsurgery, iron lungs, kidney dialysis machines, heart-lung machines, and pacemakers all took their place in medicine's armory. Research in basic science was transforming understanding of the body and its duel with disease. In particular, the astonishing expansion of genetics and molecular biology following Crick and Watson's cracking of the genetic code in 1953 have married up with the so-called second pharmacological revolution based on intracellular chemistry. Genetic screening, genetic engineering have made great headway. The Human Genome Project promises more. And at the same time, brain chemistry was opening new horizons for medicine. Endorphin research has been mastering the secrets of pain. Synthetic manipulation of neurotransmitters like L-DOPA has provided treatments for central nervous system disorders like Parkinson's disease. So long as Cinderella, clinical science has come into its own, thanks partly to randomized clinical trials developed from the mid-1940s. Some crude indices of the triumphs of clinical research are offered by Nobel Prizes awarded in the field of clinical research. In 1956, Werner Forssmann, Dickinson Richards, and André Coudenand became laureates for their daring work on cardiac catheterization. Charles Huggins received the prize for the treatment of prostate cancer with hormones. Philip Scholter-Hench for his treatment of, for his introduction of cortisone treatment for arthritis, and so on. Now, such advances in science and therapeutics haven't blossomed in a wilderness. They've arisen from the vast endowment of medicine as a social utility. In the United Kingdom, the creation of the NHS in 1948 remains a red letter day. This year, it celebrates its half century. But worldwide, nations have been developing ever larger public and private resources and devoting them to medicine. In this country and in several European community countries, more than 10% of GNP now goes on health. World Health Organization continues to expand. Global health has had some striking successes. For example, the worldwide eradication of smallpox in 1977. To put all these developments in a nutshell, two facts give a powerful, if intriguingly conflicting, evidence of the growing role of medicine. First, the approximate doubling of world population over the last 50 years, from 2,500 million in 1940 to over 500 million today, no small percentage of which is due to new medical interventions and preventions. Second, the introduction of the contraceptive pill, pioneered from the mid-50s by Gregory Pincus and Carl Gerassi, which, in theory at least, confers a safe and simple ability to control that growing population. All these developments will be well known to you, but familiarity doesn't diminish the level of the achievement. From caveman to moon landing, many revolutions have been claimed in human history. The Neolithic in agriculture, the Greek miracle, the Gutenberg revolution in printing, the 17th century scientific revolution, the industrial revolution, or revolutions, the first and the second and the third and the nth. But not until within the last half century has there been a therapeutic revolution. If we take as our yardstick the dependable ability to vanquish life-threatening disease on a vast scale, the healthiness and longevity of the rich world and the populousness of the poor world are its testaments. 19th century medical science, of course, should not be deprecated, with its remarkable advances in public health, cell biology, bacteriology, parasitology, anesthetic and antiseptic surgery. Major breakthroughs were made early in the 20th century as well. X-rays, immunology, the understanding of hormones and vitamins, chemotherapy, even, some would say, psychoanalysis. But few such strides led straight and clear to the wonderful saving of life and relief of suffering we have seen in our lifetimes. Yet the point I want to make about this is that the people aren't there, out there, cheering in the streets and waving the flags. Euphoria certainly bubbled over about antibiotics and Christian Barnard. But now the public mood has changed. Dr. Kildare is ancient history, and doctors hit the headlines today, chiefly when they commit malpractice. For all medicine success stories, who would deny a certain malaise? The atmosphere now is one of hollow conquest. Now the big battles have been won. Medicine is more open to criticism. Naturally, setbacks do not help. Drug scandals, thalidomide, etc., have sometimes proved disasters. Iatrogenic illness has grown. Research on afflictions like cancer, schizophrenia, Alzheimer's disease seems to creep along at snail's pace. Doubts remain about the very foundations of psychiatry. In Britain, the NHS has been turned into a political football and faces disintegration and conceivable dismantling, while in this country, insurance and litigation troubles dog the profession. In rich countries, the needy still get a poor medical deal. In the third world, for lack of international will, malaria and other tropical diseases are becoming even more rampant, while diphtheria and tuberculosis, once thought rampant, are now resurgent in industrialized countries, notably the former Soviet bloc. And not least, the AIDS pandemic has destroyed any naive faith that disease itself was somehow on the ropes. The fact that nearly 20 years on, AIDS remains without cure and without vaccine reminds us that only naive herbalists think that panaceas grow on trees. These cues for misgivings can be variously evaluated. Do we call partial progress success or failure? Are shortcomings to be blamed on physicians or on the politicians? But they're not the heart of the matter. For medicine is arguably going through a far more fundamental crisis, one in large part the price of progress and its attendant aspirations. Medicine is perhaps losing its way, or at least is having to redefine what its goals really are. In 1949, almost 50 years ago, in an article in the British Medical Journal, Lord Hoarder, the leading figure in medicine in Britain then, posed the question, whither medicine? And he returned the answer direct. Why? Whither else but straight ahead? But today, who can really be sure where straight ahead actually is? There was a time when the very idea of straight ahead would have been nonsense. Medicine in antiquity had no concept of future further progress. Neither the Hippocratics nor, for many centuries, their successors were explicit in projecting changes in their art onto the future. Rather, medical thinkers attempted to outdo each other in their mastery not of the future but of the past, commanding traditional texts, traditional knowledge, traditional methods, being more Galenic than thou. Antiquity, the Middle Ages, and even the Renaissance had little sense of medical progress. Now, I'm admittedly basically an 18th century historian and therefore am unspeakably biased on the matter, but I'm impressed by the way in which the 18th century developed great new aspirations about hope, in which medical luminaries drew upon the triumphs of the so-called new philosophy of the 16th and 17th century in order to create progressive profiles for medicine itself. If the noble advances of the Hippocratics, supposedly the founders of scientific medicine, had been stifled through the Middle Ages by bigoted reverence for blind authority, at last, the advent of printing, the genius of Leonardo, the daring of Vesalius, had, it was claimed, rekindled the investigative spirit. Harvey was the ideal icon. His connections with Padua and his impeccable experimentalism bespoke a new and happy marriage of medicine with science, enshrined above in the emblem of the heart as pump, perfect proof that knowledge advanced when medicine and the mechanical philosophy pulled together. As Thomas Sydenham, the so-called English Hippocrates, noted in 1669, the great improvements some parts of medicine have received within the last few years give me confidence to believe it is yet capable of great additions. Enlightenment thinkers in the 18th century elaborated this idea of progress based upon the accumulation of scientific knowledge. If you look at the article Medicine in the first great world encyclopedia, Chambers' Encyclopedia, published in the 1730s, you find this: medicine is become free of the tyranny of any sect and is improved by sure discoveries in anatomy, chemistry, physics, botany, mechanics, etc. And many other authors proclaimed progress. For example, in 1761, William Hillary spoke in his, and here the title of the book is so significant, An Inquiry into the Means of Improving Medical Knowledge. He spoke of improvements which would lead to what he called greater perfection. And thus, he concluded, we may reasonably hope to further both the theory and practice of physic, and so render the art more successful and the science more beneficial to mankind. And it was about that time that Samuel Johnson coined that phrase, the greatest benefit to mankind, to describe contemporary medicine. It will be easy to quote from leading luminaries of the time, Boerhaave in Holland, Cullen in Scotland, on the subject. I want to mention briefly a completely obscure medical individual, a man called Samuel Wood, famous for nothing except that he wrote about gout, and I've just been writing history of gout, and so I've been reading his books. Samuel Wood writes as follows: the practice of physic has now been undertaken for more than 2,000 years, and very many are the improvements in the cure of diseases and the use and variety of medicines which were unknown to the ancients. And then he gives an almost sort of religious litany of improvement after improvement in liturgical cadences. Let me just read out a few in order to give that sense of almost ecclesiastical holiness with which he treats the progress of medicine. Since the lymphatics have been discovered and the structure and use of the glands fully displayed, we are much more able to explain and account for diseases which arise from a fault in the glands and lymphatics. Since the structure of the viscera, lungs, brain, and liver have been known, the origin and diseases incident to these organs have been much better understood. Since we now know the admirable fabric of the uterus, then we can account for the diseases of that organ and the symptoms attendant upon them on clear and intelligible principles. And so his book goes on for page after page, listing all the departments of progress. And he concludes as follows: from this cursory review of the present improved state of medical knowledge, it is evident we have greatly the advantage of our ancestors. In consequence of the happy effects of these discoveries, we now see many diseases cured with facility with which the afflicted of those days bore and closed a wretched existence. Thus, increasingly in the 16th and 17th and 18th centuries, medical writers looked to the progress of knowledge and thereby of therapeutics. Above all, however, they also saw for medicine not just a progressive future, not just a glorious future, but a more noble and humane mission for medicine as well: the democratic triumph of health. And I want to spend a few minutes talking about that noble humanitarian ideal. In North America, Benjamin Rush, so-called founder of American medicine, physician, and signatory to the Declaration of Independence. And in Britain, various people, including a man called William Buchan, author of the best-selling book Domestic Medicine, pictured the improvement of health as not just medically desirable, but as essential to human emancipation at large. Freedom from fear, freedom from want, freedom from suffering. If, till now, the medical profession had, alas, all too often taken a leaf out of the priest's book, pursuing a closed shop and cynically keeping the people in the dark, this dark age, as Benjamin Rush put it, would soon end. Physic was about to be laid open to the people. Health and humanity would march forward together. Now, Benjamin Rush's opinions will be familiar to most of you in this audience. Less so, perhaps, will be those of William Buchan, and so I'll talk a little bit about those. William Buchan's Domestic Medicine was the most successful text of popular medicine written by a regularly trained doctor. It ran through literally scores of cheap editions and was complemented by another book of his called Observation Concerning the Prevention and Cure of the Venereal Disease. Buchan's works probably appealed to craftsmen, artisans, shopkeepers, the petty bourgeoisie. It was said that every Scottish crofter supposedly had a copy of Buchan alongside the Bible by their bedside. Houses that only had two books had a copy of Buchan. Unlike that earlier medical bestseller for the people, John Wesley's Primitive Physic, Buchan went beyond mere do's and don'ts and remedies and expounded a broad philosophy of positive well-being to be achieved through temperance and hygiene in accordances with the dictates of nature, and he had great faith in nature's healing powers, and explaining the laws of disease and health to the people, the signs and symptoms of disorders, and the best of home therapeutics. Buchan set out a populist philosophy of medicine, drawing upon the democratic political philosophies of the late 18th century, the age of American independence and French Revolution. And he did this, he said, with a view to, I quote, rendering medicine more extensively beneficial to mankind. He painted an historical picture of ingrained folly and exploitation, in which, as he put it, the credulity of mankind in regard to medicine has been truly astonishing. Popular ignorance had been exploited. Buchan's works aimed to safeguard sufferers against quackery and to instruct those not able to employ regular doctors because of cost or inaccessibility. His writings, I quote, were not designed to supersede the physician, but in some measure to supply his place where he cannot be had. For, as he put it, to talk of making all men physicians is the extreme of folly. And in this he was presumably not being disingenuous. After all, he was himself a lifetime general practitioner. Nevertheless, the drift of both his books was that the prudent sufferer could, most of the time, dispense with the physician with safety and even with advantage. And he recommends that patients, sensible patients, should be able to treat, for example, dislocated necks or venereal disease themselves without even the need of a doctor. Now, Buchan vested no naive faith in folksy wisdom or in plebeian lifestyles. He wasn't into alternative medicine. Bizarre medical reviews received short shrift from him. Some of them, some folk remedies, for example, the idea that the way to cure venereal disease was to go and have sex with a virgin. He wasn't sure whether they were more, as he put it, wicked or absurd. Not least, ordinary people habitually failed to comply with doctors' orders, and that was dumb. So, what was the explanation of this dreadful state of affairs? As Buchan put it, physic is still engrossed by the faculty and has succeeded accordingly. Very ironical verdict. He insinuated that physicians had long and perniciously and cynically maintained medicine as an illiberal mystery, a closed shop couched in a dead tongue, to gratify the sordid desire for greed amongst those, as he put it, who would make a trade of it. Popish priests had turned religion into mumbo jumbo, and physicians had similarly turned medicine into doctorcraft. Speaking specifically about venereal disease, but in terms applicable to all disorders, he wrote as follows: while people are kept in the dark and told they are not to use their understanding in matters that concern their health, they will be the dupes of designing knaves. The medical establishment had traditionally sought to monopolize knowledge and practice. Quoting Benjamin Rush, a man who, as he put it, holds the same liberal sentiments concerning medicine as I do, Buchan complained about this ancient monopoly, but then looked forward to a better state of affairs. I quote, "A new order of things is rising in medicine as well as in government. Air, water, and light are now taken without the advice of a physician." For that reason, he said, he endorsed Rush's optimism about future prospects. Human reason cannot be stationary on these subjects. The time must come and will come when, in addition to the existing remedies, the general use of calomel and jollop and the lancet shall be considered amongst the most essential articles of the knowledge and the rights of man. Astonishing thing to hear being said. There would be no holding back of progress. Rush and Buchan thus aim to promote popular medicine in an age of democratic politics. "It is no more necessary," writes Buchan, once again approving of what Rush had said before him, "that a patient should be ignorant of the medicine that he takes than that the business of government must be conducted with secrecy." Respecting the people's health, the past, he thought, had been a nightmare, a time of, as he put it, ignorance, superstition, and quackery. Yet light was dawning. To bring medicine out of the schools, to lay open its hidden treasures, and to teach men a proper use of them, has been reserved for the present age. But progress would be slow, because those who have taught medicine have taken away the key of knowledge. Above all, Buchan, Rush, and many contemporaries believed that medicine ought to be democratized. I quote, "The practical part of medicine is within the reach of common sense. Hence, it was important for men to think and reason for themselves." Thus, Buchan expounded what he called the benevolent wishes for the whole human race, which he entertained, embracing what he called the emancipation of medicine, a goal to be achieved, I quote, "by committing the care of diseases to the people." He never quite said medicine for the people, by the people, amongst the people, but he almost did. So what kind of a future seemed to lie in store for medicine? Instructed in medical self-help by humane and enlightened and democratic physicians like himself, the sick would largely be empowered to tend their own conditions, and the medical profession would gradually begin to wither away somewhat. For little in medicine ought to be beyond the skill of the sensible layman. In Rush and in Buchan, we see the Enlightenment ideal of a people's medicine in its most triumphant and confident form. Now, let's fast forward and compare the hopes of these 18th century prophets of progress with the realities of the 20th century. If, in the 18th century, medicine had advanced and yet still lagged, in the present century, medicine has grown all-conquering, commanding, and costly. And as its publicity has correspondingly mushroomed, the upshot has been a crescendo of criticism. From the epidemiological vantage point, Professor Thomas McEwen and others have thrown down the gauntlet. Is not higher life expectancy, which is commonly credited to medicinal science, in reality is it not the fruit in reality of improved living standards, nutrition, public health, etc.? In his book, The Role of Medicine, McEwan asked just that. What is the role of medicine? And the options he offered in his subtitle were as follows: dream, mirage, or nemesis. Now, here was a distinguished medical professor back in the 1960s and 70s questioning exactly where medicine was going. The reader might well decide that medicine had largely been the reinforcements that arrived after the battle for health had actually largely been won. From the 1950s, the new medical sociology put medicine under the microscope and sometimes on the couch. One school of sociologists mounted critiques of professional dominance. Another contended that the very categories of medicine, the notions themselves of health and sickness, and also specific diagnostic terms, were not scientific realities at all, but rather grids of social labels, often involving scapegoating and the designation of deviants with regard to class and race and gender. And nor was this just the ritual chanting of trendy lefties. At mid-century, even that doyen of conservative Harvard sociologist Talcott Parsons drew attention to what he called the sick role, a notion which potentially reduced the entire estate of medicine to a form of extremely elaborate social ritual. Since then, numerous sociologists have characterized medicine as a form of social control, or words to that effect. In other words, once medicine grew mighty, it drew critics. And once it proved effective, the scourge of pestilence was forgotten, and the physician became viewed by critics primarily as a figure of authority, or maybe a tool of patriarchy, or the stooge of the state. And in one other key respect, medicine was to become the prisoner of its own success. Having finally conquered many grave diseases and provided relief for suffering, its mandate has now become muddled. What are its aims? Where is it to stop? Is its prime duty to keep people alive as long as possible, willy-nilly, whatever the circumstances? Is its charge to make people lead healthy lives? Or is it but a service industry on tap to fulfill whatever fantasies its clients may frame for their bodies, be it endless cosmetic surgery or the longing of women of 59 to have babies, and if not 59, then why not 69 or 89? Here, the hot topic of human cloning concentrates the mind on these issues. In the individual case, many of these quandaries can be resolved reasonably satisfactorily with the aid of common decency. Excuse me. With the aid of common decency, goodwill, and a sensible ethics committee. But in the wider world, who can decree for the directions medicine may now be taking? Now that, in the rich world at least, medicine has accomplished many of its traditional basic targets as understood by Hippocrates or William Harvey, who now decides its mission? In this situation, public alarm is bound to grow over the high-tech, can-do, will-do approach apparently embraced by scientific medicine at its cutting edge, the elite of which sometimes seems more concerned in extending medicine's technical prowess with scant regard for ends and values. Where patients are seen as problems and reduced to biopsies and lab tests, no wonder sections of the public vote with their feet and opt for styles of so-called holistic medicine which present themselves as more patient-friendly or humane. But if the switch to alternative medicine is symptomatic of a malaise, what might be more disquieting than public rejection of medicine is public fixation upon it. In an age in which consumer choice counts and democratic rights have become more vocally expressed than ever. In a fascinating book called Disease Mongers, published in 1992, Lynn Payer has explored the irony that the healthier Western society gets, the more medicine it takes. Especially in this country, intense pressures are created by the medical profession, by medi-business, by the media, by dutiful or susceptible individuals to expand the diagnosis of treatable illnesses. Scares are created. People are bamboozled into having more and more lab tests, often of dubious reliability. Thanks to what has been called diagnostic creep or leap, ever more disorders, lo and behold, are discovered. Extensive and expensive treatments are then urged. The physician who chooses not to treat may well leave himself exposed to malpractice accusations, or the physician who doesn't treat doesn't get paid. Anxieties and interventions spiral upwards. Practitioners, lawyers, and pharmaceutical companies do well, even if patients don't get well, and medicine loses its course. The doing better, feeling worse syndrome. The root of the trouble is structural. It's endemic to a medical system in which an expanding medical establishment with growing technical power and faced with a healthier population of its own creation is inevitably driven to medicalizing normal life events, to converting risks into diseases, to treating trivial complaints with fancy procedures. Doctors and consumers alike may be becoming locked within a fantasy that unites anxiety making with can-do, must-do technological perfectibilism. Everybody has something wrong with them. Everybody can be cured. As the old joke goes, the healthy person is but an incomplete diagnosis. And we may be slipping into a medical McDonald's world in which phobias and superfluous therapeutics may jeopardize health no less than disease itself. Possibly medical success is creating a kind of Frankenstein's monster. It is what that 1970s guru Ivan Illich called the medicalization of life with a vengeance. To conclude, medical consumerism, like all sorts of consumerism, only maybe more menacingly, is unsatisfying. Indeed, one wouldn't have to be unduly cynical to suggest that in some quarters at least, it is designed to be unsatisfying. The prolongation of life and the search for perfect health and beauty and youth and happiness are inevitably self-defeating in the long run. The law of diminishing returns necessarily applies. You can make higher percentages of people survive into their 80s and 90s. But as any geriatric ward shows, that's not the same thing as conferring enduring mobility, awareness, autonomy, and happiness. Extending life daily grows more medically feasible. But what if it's a life sans everything, one exposed to degrading neglect, especially as, in coming decades, resources grow overstretched and politics may turn mean? What an ignominious destiny for medicine if its future became one of bestowing meager increments of unenjoyed life. It might mirror the fate of athletics, in which disproportionate energies and resources, not least medical ones, as in illegal drugs, are now invested to shave records by milliseconds. To air these predicaments is not a matter of anti-medical spleen. It's not a churlish reprisal against medicine for its victories, but it's simply to face facts, to face the growing reality of medical power, not exactly without responsibility, but with mirage-like dissolving goals. Hence, medicine's finest hour may become the dawn of its dilemmas. For centuries, medicine was impotent and hence unproblematic. If you can't do anything, it doesn't matter what you don't do. From the Greeks to the Great War, its job was simple: to struggle with lethal diseases and gross disabilities, to ensure live births, and to manage pain. It performed these uncontroversial tasks for century after century, by and large with some, but with meager success. There was very little sense of choice. Today, with mission accomplished in large measure, medicine's triumphs may be dissolving into disorientation. Medicine has led to inflated expectations, which the public has eagerly swallowed. Yet as these expectations grow unlimited, they become unfulfillable. The task facing medicine in the 21st century will be to redefine its limits, even as it extends its capacities. And that will need profound debate concerning precisely what medicine is for. If that debate is to be well informed, it must be based upon an understanding of medicine's history. Thank you very much. Sure, please.
As a companion to self-treatment, do you see the individual patient to be a self-appointed ethics committee or bioethics committee?
What an interesting question. And it seems to me that there was in the past, in particular in Europe, a self-appointed one-person ethics committee, and that was the physician. And that age has now gone, for better or for worse. It had its virtues because, as it were, the physician is in certain positions to know what is best for the patient. But also the patient wants to have his or her say in what is good for them. And we now live in a world in which, because of various sorts of things, the empowerment of people, the consumers, movement, the fragmentation of medicine, and not least, the ability to hop on an aeroplane and go to Mexico when you want to have treatments that are not permitted here, then we live in a world in which the patient must be a very powerful voice in that ethics committee when we decide what we are going to do about things like human cloning and all the other genetically engineered new possibilities with regard to reproductive technologies that are just around the corner. It seems to me that, as it were, it is essential that one listens to the voice of all sorts of people and their wishes in terms of their life futures, and that the physicians shouldn't necessarily reduce themselves to facilitators, that's to say, means to ends service industries. But unless the desires of people with regard to things like euthanasia or living wills or the sorts of families they want are listened to, then people will, as always, vote with their feet and go to the quacks or go to the third world and get what they want done somewhere else.
What would you do if you were at home and had a serious illness yourself? And what would be the economic transactions that would concern that? Do you have health insurance yourself? Do you go to the National Health? Do you have your own physician? How is your health care obtained?
My health care is the same as it is for, at one level, every single citizen and resident of the United Kingdom, and for 92% of people who have opted to use that system, that is to say, the National Health Service. And the National Health Service is an enigma. And it's an enigma for this reason, that English people like wrongly to think that it is the best health service in the world. It is, in many respects, an exceedingly good health service, but not if you want non-essential operations, not if you want certain sorts of specialist services, not if you want to be cured quickly, and not if you want a large say in the sorts of treatment that you have. It is a monolithic and fairly bureaucratic and still quite paternalistic system, which nevertheless, despite its enormous flaws and deficiencies, commands overwhelming loyalty. And that's one of the great enigmas of the National Health Service, which is that if many Americans went to England and underwent the sorts of treatments or non-treatments that you get under the NHS, you would be appalled. But English people not only are unbelievably patient and stoical, but they are chauvinistic about the NHS as well. And that is partly because there is still a sort of Second World War mentality surviving amongst the English. You know, when in doubt, form a queue. The longer you wait, the better it is for you. With any luck, if you wait at least 2 years for your operation, the condition will have healed itself and you won't need the operation in the first place. I mean, there is an element of that. At the same time, as amongst the English, there is still a level of health expectations that is incredibly low by American standards. I mean, we don't even get our teeth fixed straight. You know, it's seen as vanity to go to an orthodontist in England. And what is quite interesting about the NHS is that we had 18 years of Thatcher government. Thatcher government was Reagan government. It looked to many people as though Thatcher was going to dismantle the NHS and bring in a system either like HMOs or based upon individual health insurance or employer health insurance or all sorts of things like that. She certainly greatly admired many aspects of American competition and free market medicine, etc. And she had advisors who were pressing for that. And virtually nothing happened. And it looks as though she had a perception that the British public were not easily going to be divested of their maybe crude and superstitious faith in a National Health Service, which everybody knows is actually unbelievably cost effective. I mean, Britain spends half of the percentage of its GNP on health than America does. And roughly speaking, I think it gets a better deal for every dollar expended. And that, I mean, certainly to answer your question, if you say, if I get seriously sick, what do I do? Then the answer is, I go to my national health doctor, because I know that if I'm seriously sick, then the National Health Service will look after me as well as a private physician. If I want my varicose veins fixed fast, then if I weren't so ideologically bigoted as I am, I mean, I'm a left-wing bigot when it comes to these things, but if I weren't a bigot, then I'd go to a private doctor, because then I could get it done next week rather than in 30 months' time.
Well, if there are no other questions, perhaps we can thank Roy Porter again. He will be available to sign copies of the book. If you have not bought a copy yet and you'd like to buy a copy and get it signed, he'll be sitting over here to do that. And let me remind you that on May 20th, the section on historical medicine will be sponsoring a talk by Charles Rosenberg on a popular sex manual published in this country in the 19th century. Rosenberg, of course, has done some important work on Buchan, whom we heard about tonight, and is probably the leading historian of American medicine. We're very pleased to be able to follow this great talk by another talk by an important historian of medicine. That's May 20th. Thank you.
Sunday night at 8, Book Notes. Author Robert Sobel talks